Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum, dear students. Welcome to the online lecture on control systems theory. Today we are going to discuss a controller design example for second order systems. In this example, we will see we have recently studied the transient specifications for a standard second order system, and we have discussed the formulas for rise time, settling time, percentage overshoot, and so on. So this lecture is basically this lecture builds upon that one, and we will see that how we can use the transient specification formulas that we have learned for designing a controller for a second order system that achieves the desirable specifications. So the problem that we are going to discuss today is that given the system of the with the following transfer function g of s equal 1 over s into s plus 1. So this is like this transfer function has two poles, therefore it is a second order transfer function. One of the pole is at 0 and the other pole is at minus 1. So our problem is that we have to design a controller for this system to achieve the following specifications. The specifications are, number one, closed loop system should be asymptotically stable. Number two, there should be zero steady state error with respect to step input. And number three, percentage overshoot of the closed loop system should be less than or equal to 5%. And finally, the settling time of the closed loop system should be less than 4 seconds. So let's see how we go about designing the controller. Here is a diagram that basically shows you the scenario. We have the plant. We know that the input is going to be step input, but we don't know what kind of controller will work to achieve the desired specifications. So first of all, we design for stability. For that purpose we choose or try P controller. Please do remember this, that in all the controller design problems, the simplest possible controller should be applied, because your design, the simpler your design, the easier it would be to implement practically. So we always look for the simplest possible controller, and the simplest possible controller is P controller. If the P controller does not work for some reason or fails to achieve certain desired specifications, only then we go for more advanced controllers. So we try P controller, and then C of S will be KP, a simple gain, constant gain. In this scenario, the closed loop transfer function will become C into G over 1 plus C into G. In this case, it will become KP over S square plus S plus KP. And if you look at this transfer function, then according to Routh-Hurwitz criteria that we have studied in this course, the closed loop asymptotic stability shall be achieved for any positive value of KP. Next, we design for steady state accuracy. So we require that the steady state error due to step input should be zero for the closed loop system. Luckily, this system is of type 1. So without even trying to design a special controller for this system, we already are achieving steady state error with respect to step equal to zero. Why? Because the given system in itself is a type 1 system, and for type 1 systems, steady state error with respect to step is always zero. That we have discussed in the lecture regarding steady state errors for systems of different types. So P controller is fine as far as the steady state performance is concerned. So far P controller is okay for asymptotic stability. P controller is okay as far as the steady state performance is concerned. Next, we design the P controller to achieve the transient specifications. What are the transient specifications? First of all, we need to have the overshoot to be less than or equal to 5%, and secondly, we need to have settling time to be less than or equal to 4 seconds. So first we recast the desirable specs into admissible pole locations. So what are the admissible pole locations? These are the pole locations for the closed loop system such that the performance specifications are achieved. Please note that the settling time, overshoot and everything depends upon the pole locations. So if we want to achieve specific overshoot or specific settling time, then it always translates into pole locations. So in this case, the desirable settling time is less than or equal to 4 seconds. If we apply the formula for settling time for second order systems, that is 3.2 divided by zeta omega n, then in order to keep the settling time less than or equal to 4, we need to have zeta times omega n to be greater than or equal to 0.8. So we'll come back to it. Secondly, for desirable percentage overshoot, we need to have zeta greater than or equal to 0.7. If you refer to my previous lecture, then you will see that the graph between percentage overshoot and zeta shows that for zeta greater than or equal to 0.7, the percentage overshoot is about 4.3 or less, 4.3% or less. Okay, so these are the desirable values of zeta and omega n translated from the desirable values of settling time and percentage overshoot. So this figure basically shows that how the location of the pole is related to zeta and omega n. You look at this diagram and the little x on the top right quadrant, that is the pole. If you draw a vector from pole to the origin, then the angle between that vector and the negative x-axis is theta, and zeta is basically cos of theta. And similarly, the x-axis distance of the pole from the j omega axis is zeta times omega n. So this gives us the admissible pole locations. So the admissible pole locations are basically to the left of the vertical line that is drawn at minus 0.8. So the distance of the pole from the j omega axis, which is zeta into omega n, should be more than 0.8. So the pole should be located on the left hand side of the vertical line that you see on the right side or bottom right diagram of your slide screen. And I've also shaded this region into light gray color. Hopefully you are able to see that. This region is basically the region of admissible pole locations. One thing contributing to this region is the vertical line, which corresponds to the condition that zeta into omega n should be greater than or equal to 0.8. The other thing that is contributing to this region is the cone, the 45 degree cone. Since zeta has to be greater than or equal to 0.7, please remember that excuse me sorry about that. Please remember that cos of 0.707, cos inverse of 0.707 is 45 degrees, because 0.707 is 1 over under root 2. So cos of 45 degree is 1 over under root 2, and cos inverse of 1 over under root 2 is 45 degrees. So the condition that zeta should be greater than or equal to 0.707 translates into a cone of plus minus 45 degrees. So the poles should be within this cone of plus minus 45 degrees. So summing up, the admissible location for the poles of the closed loop system, based on the requirement that settling time should be less than or equal to 4 seconds and the overshoot should be less than or equal to 5%, is given on the diagram as shown. So the final location of the pole should be the distance from the j omega axis should be greater than 0.8, and the pole should be within the 45 degree cone of on the left side of the complex. So now that we have found the admissible pole locations, we should look to find the value of Kp that can basically make the closed loop poles come within that admissible region. So recall that the closed loop transfer function with Kp, the p controller, is Kp over s square plus s plus Kp. If you look at the characteristic equation, that is s square plus s plus Kp equals 0. The roots of this equation will become minus 0.5 plus minus square root of 0.25 minus Kp. So if we try to adjust Kp so that the poles will have real part less than minus 0.8 and the imaginary part should be such that the poles should lie within the cone of plus minus 45 degree. So we try to adjust the Kp, and when Kp is less than or equal to 0.25, both poles will be real and at least one of the poles shall be to the right of minus 0.5. So you can see the square root term. When Kp is less than 0.25, then the square root term will be positive and it will add one time into minus 0.5 and subtract into minus 0.5 the other time. So it is not possible to make both the poles go to the left of the vertical line that is drawn at minus 0.8 with the Kp value less than 0.25. And if we have Kp greater than 0.25, then both the poles are complex conjugate because the term in the square root will become negative and the real part will be minus 0.5. And that will also not help us because we want the real part of the poles to be less than minus 0.8. So it turns out that Kp cannot drive both the poles into the admissible region. So that is a problem for us because we really need the poles to be in the admissible region. Otherwise, we shall not be able to achieve the desirable settling time and the desirable overshoot. So what can we do? We have to try another controller. So sorry about the wrong spellings of try on the slide. It's not tray another controller. It is try another controller. So since Kp has failed to achieve transients, we try PD controller. So what is a PD controller? PD controller is Kp plus Kds. We try the PD controller and then the closed loop transfer function will become Kp plus Kds divided by S square plus S into 1 plus Kd plus Kp. So this is our closed loop transfer function, and for asymptotic stability according to the Routh-Hurwitz criteria, we need the Kd to be greater than minus 1 so that the coefficient of S may be positive and the Kp should be greater than 0. So these are the constraints for asymptotic stability of closed loop system. And as far as the steady state errors is concerned, still since the original plant is type 1, using the PD controller keeps the type to be equal to 1, and so steady state error with respect to step input is 0. So we are fine as far as steady state error with respect to step is concerned. Next we go on for transient design. The characteristic equation now has become S square plus 1 plus Kd into S plus Kp equals 0, and possible closed loop poles can be found using this formula, the quadratic formula, because it's a second order characteristic equation. Well, in this case we can actually choose the pole locations to be anywhere within the admissible region, because if you look at the characteristic equation, we can play with the coefficient of S and we can play with the coefficient of the constant coefficient. The coefficient of S can be set to any value by the choice of Kd, and the constant coefficient can be set to any value by the choice of Kp. So let us suppose that I choose the closed loop pole to be at minus 1 plus minus j. So one of the closed loop pole at minus 1 minus j and the other closed loop pole at minus 1 plus j. So you can see that both of the poles shall be within the admissible region, and in this case, to make the poles, the characteristic equation that will make the poles go to minus 1 plus minus j is s square plus 2s plus 2. So s square plus 2s plus 2 has two roots, one at minus 1 plus j and one at minus 1 minus j. We want the original characteristic equation to be equal to this characteristic equation. So if we compare both equations, we see that if we set kd equal 1 and kp equal 2, then we achieve the original characteristic equation to be equal to the desired characteristic equation. So in this way we can have the poles in the desirable location. So what is the final design? Our final design of the controller that can achieve all four desired specifications is s plus 2. So kds plus kp, where kd is 1 and kp is 2. So you can see on the right side that I have drawn the poles, the closed loop poles in the admissible region where they lie. And on the bottom right of your screen you can see the closed loop system diagram, where s plus 2 is the controller and 1 over s into s plus 1 is your transfer function. So this controller achieves closed loop asymptotic stability, zero steady state error with respect to step input, percentage overshoot less than or equal to 0.5%, and settling time less than or equal to 4 seconds. And the original system without control was 1 over s into s plus 1, where there were two poles, one at the origin and one at minus 1. And with the controller, the closed loop transfer function, closed loop system has the transfer function s plus 2 over s square plus 2s plus 2. You can see that with the addition of the feedback control, the overall system has gained 1 zero. 0 is at minus 2, which is indicated by the numerator of closed loop transfer function, that is s plus 2. The root of s plus 2 is at minus 2. S equal minus 2 is the 0 of this closed loop system. And the poles of the closed loop system are the roots of the denominator of the closed loop transfer function. So you can see that no poles are added. There were two poles originally in the system, and final closed loop system also has two poles. Only the location of the pole is changed by implementing feedback, and 1 0 has been added into the system using the controller. And you can easily see that that 0 is due to the s plus 2 controller, PD controller. So since the addition of feedback control or even feed forward control basically adds poles or zeros into the overall system, so we need to know what are the effects of adding poles and zeros to a feedback control systems or even a feed forward control systems. So I'll just give you a few rules of thumb. We always add poles and zeros in open left half plane. Whenever you are designing a controller, the zeros and poles of the controller should always be on the open left half plane. There should be no zero or pole on the right half plane, because we don't want any instability issues. In feed forward control, adding poles and zeros cannot destabilize a system. That we also discussed in the beginning of this course, that feed forward control cannot destabilize a stable system. But in feedback system, adding poles and zeros can destabilize the system even if the poles are added on the left half plane. So even if you are adding poles and zeros to the open left half plane, you have to be careful about that, because that may result in destabilization of the feedback system. So overall, adding poles usually makes the response more sluggish and may even destabilize the system, and adding zeros mostly makes the response faster and may increase the overshoot. So these are the effects of adding poles and zeros. This is just a summary, and we will not cover this topic in any more depth than. So now that we have discussed the effects of adding poles and zeros, we move forward to another important concept, that is the concept of dominant poles. Generally, we have discussed in this course so far the transient specifications of first and second order systems only. We have not discussed the second order system with a zero or higher order systems. So how do we calculate different transient specification for higher order systems? It is not possible to generalize our results that we have discussed so far for every single system, but there are some special systems of higher order that can be simplified into a lower order approximation. So that is what we are going to see in this topic. So this diagram basically shows you the complex plane. If you look at the left half of complex plane, there are two strips, two gray strips. The first gray strip is close to the j omega axis, and the other gray strip is a little bit distance away from the first strip, which is also far away from the j omega axis. This first strip that is close to the j omega axis, if the poles of the system are in this region, then those poles are called dominant poles. Dominant poles because the response of the system due to, so every pole of a system contributes to the response of that system to any given input. So we apply input to a system, the response to that input, which is the output of the system, has a contribution from each of the poles. So the contribution from the poles that are closer to the j omega axis is for longer durations, and it is a dominant contribution. And the contribution due to the poles that are far away from j omega axis, that is almost insignificant and has a very short duration. So the poles in the region that is far away from the j omega axis are called insignificant poles, because their contribution is very short duration. Usually the distance between the two gray strips is not defined theoretically, or there is no theoretical proof that and for any distance to be the exact distance. It mostly depends upon the experience of the control design engineer and also on the simulation based results. Usually the distance of 5 is proves to be enough, but it's just a rule of thumb. It's not a proven fact. So insignificant poles may be dropped, and the higher order system can be approximated by its lower order version. But this should be done with care. Why am I saying that? Let's see that with an example. Suppose we have the following transfer function, g of s is equal to 11 over s plus 10 into s square plus 2 s plus 2. Now this system has three poles. One pole is at minus 10 and the two poles are at minus 1 plus minus j. So if you look at the strips, we see that two of the poles are in the strip that is close to the j omega axis, and the third pole is far away into the strip of insignificant poles. So we can basically, this pole at minus 10 is insignificant, so we can drop this pole. How do we drop this pole? We just delete it from the transfer function. If we delete it from the transfer function, then the resulting transfer function becomes 11 over s square plus 2 s plus 2. And now this is a second order transfer function. And if we take 11, if we take like 11 by 2 as a common out of this transfer function, then this will become a standard second order transfer function, 2 over s square plus 2 s plus 2, and the multiplication factor would be 11 by 2. But we are not going to go into that right now. There is one more important thing that I want to tell you about this reduction, and that is the above reduction is not right. It is not right because the DC gain is not being preserved. You can see that the original transfer function has a DC gain of 11 over 20. Because if you put s equal 0 in the original g of s, then the numerator will stay at 11 and the denominator will become 10 multiplied by 2, which is 20. But whereas in the reduced transfer function, if you put s equal 0, the DC gain will be 11 over 2. We want the DC gain to be preserved. So the correct reduction of the original transfer function shall be 11 divided by 10 into s square plus 2 s plus 2. And now in this reduced transfer function, although we have discarded the pole at s equal minus 10, but we have added another term, that is 1 over 10. to preserve the DC gain. So the DC gain of this reduced transfer function will now be 11 over 20, which is equal to the DC gain of the original transfer function. So this is what I wanted to show you about the reduction of the order of transfer function. Last thing I want to talk about is the cancelling of additional poles and zeros. What are the additional poles and zeros? So for example, your system is not second order, it's more than second order, and you want to behave it like a second order system, then you can cancel out some of the poles and zeros. But remember this, always cancel out poles and zeros on the left side of the complex plane, open left half of the complex plane. You cannot cancel out pole and zeros on the j omega axis or on the right half plane. So you can only cancel out poles and zeros on the left half of the complex plane and open left half plane. And one way to do that is by the using the pre-compensator. So you can use pre-compensator as a additional feed forward control in addition to the original feedback control C of S. You can use C sub PC of S. The way it will work is that the overall system will become a product of two transfer functions. And if in the product of two transfer functions, the pre-compensator has some zeros at the same location where the original closed loop system has poles, then the poles and zeros will cancel out with each other. And similarly, if there are some poles in the pre-compensator that are at the same location where the zeros of the closed loop transfer function are, then the zeros of closed loop transfer function will cancel out with the poles of pre-compensator. So pre-compensator is like an additional controller that you can design to get rid of extra poles and zeros in the closed loop system. But again, this has to be done with care, and we are not going to study the detail of pre-compensator design, but I just wanted to let you know that such a technique does exist in control systems theory. And if you are interested, you can go ahead and read the more details about the pre-compensator design. Overall, the controller design where there is a feedback control and there is also pre-compensator, this type of controller design is called 2-degree of freedom control design, because you have like one freedom in designing the feedback controller C of S, and another freedom is in the design of pre-compensator. So that is the end of the lecture. Summarizing today's lecture, I would say that we have gone through a controller design example for the second order system. And in this example, we have learned how to design the controller for stability, and how to design the controller for removing steady state error, and how to design the controller for transient specs, and how to derive the admissible pole locations from the given transient specs, and how to check whether your controller can achieve those transient specs or not. So if one controller does not work, you can shift to the next controller. So final design we have discussed, and then effects of adding poles and zeros, and then the concept of dominant poles, and finally an example of reducing a transfer function, and the concept of pre-compensator. That's all for this lecture. Thank you for listening.